Hey, back again, and once again I'm doing a VR, but this time to some other channel, not the ones I've been doing lately. Anyway, it's a fairly new channel. I'll admit I didn't know about them until I saw two others who I do watch. They did VRs themselves, and through that I was thinking, you know what, I might as well do it too. So I got the idea from that. And it's a very simple question, but I like it a lot, so there's that part of it too. And as many of you know, I have a tendency to go on a little too long, so I'm going to try not to do that here. We'll see. Anyway, it's a very simple thing, like I said. All it is three random games that you have and talk about them. Ones you don't really talk about all that much and give them some attention. It's fine by me. And I think I got some good ones here. One I have brought up quite a few times, though, for good reason, but I think it was worthwhile throwing it in here. But the other two I don't mention as much, even though I have brought those up before. Anyway, so let's get to it here. And the first one I was wanted to talk about here is Alien vs. Predator 2. This one's only on the computer. Obviously, it's a direct sequel to the first one, which that version anyway, was also only on the computer. It was a very good game, first-person shooter. The single-player campaigns for all three were very fun. They all worked differently. And the multiplayer was fun, too. I liked it a lot, and I played it a lot, but then this one came along, and it didn't take that long for me to realize it was that one only even more and better. And then once I finally got a hold of it, this isn't my original one, I had to replace it. It was that good, including the multiplayer, which I'll get to that specifically. It's one of those few games I can talk about that I really did like the multiplayer with, so that's another reason I wanted to talk about this one. Anyway, as far as the single-player stuff goes, again, it's much like the first one. You have to do three different species. You play as the Colonial Marines, which is standard first-person shooter stuff. You also play as the Predator, which has always been my least favorite campaign. This is. And then my favorite, the Alien, which I'll get to that one last. But all three have their story, which is mostly the same thing, overarching, and it connects eventually by the end. And I think that's one of the other things I like about this one more than the first one is, well, it did that in the first one too, and it had a decent story. This one has a pretty good story too. Whether or not which one's better, I don't know. Sometimes I go back and forth on that. But the one thing I do think that this one did better, and one of the reasons I like it, is the way it tied them in. It seemed to fit a little better. I don't know. But the Colonial Marine campaign is exactly what you expect. You got the Colonial Marines there, you got their toys, their guns, and all that kind of stuff, and a few other things. Each gun's got alternate fire mode. It's good first-person shooter stuff. The Predator is more interesting in that because they got more than just guns they can use, and you also have some toys in there that you don't really get to use in other things where you get to play as a Predator, even Predator Concrete Jungle, which is only about the Predator, and you play as one. But it works fine. I always found it to be not as interesting as the other two, but maybe that's just me. But as I said, the one I like the most is the Alien, and that just mainly comes down to how that one's played. The other two, you can pretty much run around and go gung-ho most of the time, except for Predator, you kind of have to use a little bit of stealth, obviously, you know, they turn invisible. The Aliens, while they might be a weapon themselves, are very deadly and dangerous, as we've seen many times over, and they are in this, they are still kind of fragile, and if you're not careful, it only takes like one Colonial Marine with two bursts from a pulse rifle and most difficulties to take you out, so you gotta be careful. But this meant that way intentionally, because you're supposed to go around climbing on walls, doing whatever else in the vents, and using stealth and stalking them. That's very fun. I love that. You're not shooting anything, you're just going around using stealth and trying to stalk the Colonial Marines, which is cool because you can freak them out and split them off if they're in the groups. That's really cool. It's fun. I liked it a lot. Another cool thing, even though this is happens in the very first stage of the Alien campaign, you also get to go for the Alien life cycle. You start off as a facehugger, then you turn to a chest burster for a very short time, and then you become an adult alien. It's a small thing, but it's something that adds to the game. I think it makes it very interesting, especially if you really like this kind of stuff. It's pretty cool. And it handles the other two, the Marines and the Predator, much in the same way. It definitely feels like each one is what it is and it's supposed to work. And again, because they all work differently, that makes it fun too. The campaigns aren't the longest thing ever, but they're not very short either at the same time. They're generally, all three of them are about the same length, but not exactly. That's hard to explain. You can't measure it like that. But this, what I'm getting at is this carries over into the multiplayer, which I had a ton of fun with while it lasted. The servers are long gone now, unless you have enough copies of it and computers you play at LAN, I guess. But it's still fun to play single player, of course. But anyway, the multiplayer was absolutely crazy and fun, again, because all three different species work differently, and it creates some pretty hectic multiplayer matches. And obviously you stick with whatever you play as best. Again, it was the Alien, although that worked a lot different in multiplayer where you barely got to sneak around much because human people playing much smarter than the AI. Although, to be fair, the AI in this is pretty smart. It's not unfair or ridiculous like it magically knows you're there. It works well, more than some other games that have some kind of stealth mechanic in it. I mean, it's better than, say, like Skyrim's stealth. But anyway, multiplayer I really liked a lot in this. In fact, I played the multiplayer more than I did the single player overall. And it was a ton of fun. I loved it. And the other thing I liked about it was the stages, which were really cool. The best one, one of the most popular ones, which I could see why I liked it a lot too, was one based on Alien 3. And again, if you've seen the movie, you know exactly what I'm getting at here. It's basically modeled after the very tight areas and corridors they were all running through trying to take care of the one alien before they activated the furnace thing and dumped the hot lead on it. And it even has the piston that works just like in the movie, which one of the best things was trying to intentionally trap people in there who are on opposing teams and see who was willing to kill who and if they could do it fast enough and get out before the piston trapped them in there. That was really cool. It's a small thing again, but it went a long way, I think. It was very fun. Anyway, that's enough about Alien vs. Predator 2. It's a great game. Unfortunately, GOG doesn't have that one yet, but they do have the first one. I don't know. Just figured I'd throw it in there. This is one, by the way, I do recommend if you want to play it, definitely go with GOG because it's an old FMV game and they're a pain in the ass to get running these days. It's not impossible, but some are more difficult than others, and this one's fairly difficult. Anyway, so next one here is Phantasmagoria 2 Puzzle of Flesh. Obviously a sequel to the first one, which is actually advertised on the back here. Here's the thing, though. This one here is a sequel in name only. Other than it's the same type of game, it's an FMV adventure game, horror game, but it doesn't do horror nearly as well as the first one. The first one wasn't perfect, and it didn't get all the best glowing reviews, but it did get quite a lot of good ones, and not as many negative ones as this. They were almost pretty much only got negative reviews. Part of the reason for that, I always thought, and I still think that now, because this is the kind of thing that happens when a certain writer or person who's key to a certain thing, movie, book, whatever, isn't a part of it. Roberta Williams was part of the first one. And this one, in many times, believe it or not, was actually a very good FMV adventure game, and sometimes it could pass for a very, very low-budget horror movie. It pulled that off well. It was very creepy, disgusting, and had really good horror elements. And of course, everyone knows that one scene where the guy's shoving meat chunks, which are just cut-up body parts, down that person's throat. You can find it on YouTube. It's very easy to find. Just put in Phantasmagoria, the first one, and it's probably like the third thing that'll pop up, if not the first. Anyway, it's just one example, but it does have legitimately good horror elements to that game. This one, they kind of bone that on, but that doesn't mean it's not fun. I mean, well, I can jump ahead. Basically, for me and many others, the reason we like this is not because it's better than the first one, which it's not, or even that good of a game. It's got that whole bad movie is fun quality to it. It's very cheesy. They went ridiculous with this one more than the first one. There was a few intentionally to be funny things in the first one, and it worked, but it went out of the way and it went back to the horror stuff, which, okay, fine. And the puzzles were fairly well thought out for the most part. I mean, this one's got that too, but there's some that are just ridiculous. I mean, there's a few in this that are basically like Discworld level logic that you got to figure out. I'll give you an example here, even though I keep going on too long. But the horror the gore and stuff in that is a lot more faker in this one than it was in the first one. It wasn't in this than the first one. It wasn't as effective, really, to be honest. And it was just a lot more cheesy. And FMV games, even the first one, suffers from this too, the bad acting and dialogue. This one suffers from it a lot more. But if you take all that aside and enjoy it like a bad movie, you're never going to be bored. I mean, that's the thing with this. You'll be frustrated with some of the puzzles, no doubt. I still am to this day, even though I know what you're supposed to do. But you're never going to be bored with this one. There's a lot of quotable lines, a lot of things that'll make you laugh, even though you're not supposed to. And there's some of the characters are pretty enjoyable. But just like the first one, this is not for kids. It was a very adult game, and most people forget about this. I'll just mention this real quick, because it's always been overshadowed by Mortal Kombat and a few others. The first Phantasmagoria, and then a little bit of this one, because this came out a few years later. This, just like the first one, came under flack for the content it had in it. I mean, pretty much the first page in this warns you about that kind of stuff. For example, a couple times in this, you go to an S&M club, there are basically on the level of Cinemax sex scenes in this almost, and on top of all the other crazy shit. The supernatural stuff, and it's also got, like, the devil and all that, and just, you see that by the time you get to the end. It's some weird stuff that goes on in this. But it's never boring, is the point I'm getting at. It's fun. Is it better than the first one? No. I still like the first one more. I mean, that one even got a port on the Saturn only in Japan. This one didn't even get that, so, whatever. It's still an enjoyable game, despite all those problems. Like I said, treat it like a bad movie, and you'll probably absolutely love it, and I do. In some ways, I kind of get more entertainment out of it than the first one, because of that. Even though it's not as good of a game. And especially in terms of the story, which I'll leave it at this. The story is, well, like I said, is the same kind of thing. It's a horror, supernatural theme type deal, like the first one is. Only it makes less sense most of the time. It really is out there. And then, you know, I'm not going to ruin it, but because I don't like doing that with stories and games, but it's pretty weird, let me tell you. But as I said, I was going to give you an example for the weird logic. The first thing you have to do in this game puzzle can actually get you stuck there if you've never played it before, and it's pretty annoying, actually. Again, if you don't know what you're doing. you play as Curtis Craig here, and he's got a rat named Blob, whatever. The dumbass lost his wallet underneath his damn futon for some reason, which, again, game logic, if it actually gave you the option to reach your noodle arm in there and feel around for it, you could probably get it. Although, then again, given stuff that happens in the game, it's probably a good thing you don't have that option. Whatever, if you played it, you know what I mean. So you're supposed to know, you have a half-eaten chocolate bar. You're supposed to wave that, use that, wave it underneath the futon. Blob comes out. Not only that, the rat also knows to bring your wallet out with you. So then you can go to work, you can use the passcode, the key card in your wallet, because you need that to get into your office space, to start working on the Venom document, and then have Bob the Brown Noser work on you and all that kind of stuff, and then his girlfriend interrupt him when he's trying to work on the Venom document, and then all the other stuff going on. That's just the first puzzle you gotta do. Some of the others are a lot more basic, but that first one is kind of ridiculous. It's like, yeah, I'm supposed to know that's gonna work. But then that's kind of typical of most adventure games. I'm just saying, in this one, it's got weird stuff like that, and then some. So, whatever. It's worth playing, I think. Whatever. I've gone on about this one long enough. This is the one I had to be careful I didn't go on too long about. I could have gone on even longer about it, trust me. Anyway, so last but not least, and this is the one I said that maybe I could have went with something else, but I think it was a good decision to keep this in here. I don't really have all that much I can say about it, even though technically I could. It's one of my favorite games of all time, and it's my favorite Saturn game, Guardian Heroes. It's absolutely fantastic. It's a treasure game, by the way, also. I had this way back when it was new, North American release, but these days it's cheaper to get the Japanese version, obviously. Anyway, long story short, with the story of this, it's not that interesting. It's the actual game itself. Playing it is the main draw, always has been for me. The story goes like this. Basically, a magical sword falls into the world, gets obtained by a group of heroes, who are the ones you can choose to play as. And then, blah, 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 they go set out to change the fate of their entire kingdom. Yeah, there's nothing that special or interesting. There's a lot more to it, of course. There's actually a lot of dialogue in this. It's not a straight-up beat-em-up, even though primarily that's what it is, but it's also like kind of like part adventure game, and it's got RPG elements, which is another reason I like it so much. It's just the overall whole package, I guess you could say, with this game that's always had me enthralled with it. Way back when I first got it, it was one of those kind of games with rare... Back then, I did it more than I do now. It was kind of one of those games I wanted sight unseen. I seen it in magazines, I saw it around... I think I even saw a commercial or two or something like that. I don't know. It's too far back for me to remember to be sure. But I saw it around in game stores and all that, and I just, looking at the case of it and the picture and all that, and talking to one or two other people who I knew had it, I had to have it. I was like, this is something that I absolutely would go for crazy on my Saturn. And so I asked for it quite a few times, if I remember, and that Christmas I ended up getting it. And I was hooked on it. I didn't want to stop playing it, really. It's a ton of fun. You have many different characters you can play as, all work differently. They all have their own moveset, which is one of the things I like about this, by the way. I'm not going to call it a fighting game, even though technically beat-em-ups are under that umbrella, but it does each character have their own kind of combos, but they're simple enough combos, I could say, that I can handle it, because I've mentioned many times before, many of you have been watching me for a long time now, I'm not good at fighting games, but this one, the combos in this are short enough and simple enough to just get, and a lot of them are kind of similar between the characters, but they all have their own different moves, like I said. You also have magic you use, too. Which, some characters are more magic-focused, some are more combat-focused, but despite which one you do, or whatever character you play as, you can still use magic. But also, the spells between them change. You also have some other special moves which use that bar. But you have that going on with it, too. You also have kind of a, as usually it's called, 2.5D, where you can jump. It's a 2D game, technically, on a 2D plane, but it has 3D elements to it. And you have different planes you can jump back and forth between to fight enemies, and they all do it, too. So you can kind of use that as defense, as also as just to take on whatever enemy. It's got boss fights, which are pretty cool. They all work differently. Each character is different and interesting. They have their own quirks, and they're entertaining, you know, for the dialogue and all that. And you also have an arena you can fight in, which is pretty much like the challenge within the game, because it's not easy. You definitely got to be on the ball to do that one and last. It's good practice, though. Don't get me wrong. It's got great music, and it also has really cool anime cutscenes, which are very reminiscent of basically like Chrono Trigger type visual style. That's the best comparison I can kind of make, but it's not exactly. I don't know how to explain that kind of stuff. I'm not good at it. Overall, it's just an amazing game. And if you've never played it, definitely play it. Of course, many of you probably might know, and if not, that's probably the version you got. Later on, they ported it to the Xbox 360 with Xbox Live Arcade with some changes. I've always preferred the Saturn version myself. That's how I played it originally. And there's a sequel in the Game Boy Advance, but this one in particular, the first one here, awesome game. I still say, to me anyway, is one of the best beat-em-ups I've ever played. It is my favorite beat-em-up, and it's also, like I said, my favorite game for the Saturn. And one last thing I'll say is, this is, it kind of sounds funny to say this, but maybe many of you can understand this. I know I've explained this about Outrun for me in a few other games, Doom kind of to a lesser extent. Guardian Heroes here, for me, is kind of one of those special games, I guess you could say, in that it all comes together enough for me. And it does have downsides, don't get me wrong, it definitely does. It's far from the easiest game ever. I mean, that's not a problem with it, but it's just like, if you're expecting to like not have that much opposition, you're going to be kind of surprised by that. It is fairly difficult, but that's one of the things I like about it too. Anyway, this game I like so much, and just the way it is, the whole overall game itself, the package, I guess. This one game is enough that is reason why I like the Saturn so much. This one game right here. Not joking. I like it that much. So that should tell you something right there. And it is a fantastic game. Definitely even more fun when you're playing with others, which I only got to do that a few times, unfortunately, but you know, it was enough for me. Even playing solo is fun. You got AI partners with you, so you're not always by yourself. So that's pretty cool. I don't know. It's an absolutely a fantastic game, and of all three of these games I've talked about here, and then despite how much I like Phantasmagoria 2, I definitely say I would recommend this over that one, and AVP 2. But, of course, more people, you know, accessible for this because it's not a computer game. Of all three of these games, I gotta say, this is definitely the more unique and interesting one, and better game. Definitely check it out, it's awesome. So, yeah, especially if you like the Saturn and somehow you've never played it yet. Anyway, so there you go, that's it. I went on a little too long, as usual, sorry, but maybe you found that what I had to say interesting in the games I went with again. Alien vs. Predator 2 for the for the computer, and Phantasmagoria 2, A Puzzle of Flesh, and last but not least, Guardian Heroes here for the Saturn. Anyway, that's it. Of course, as always, I'll have a link down below in the description to Team Chav's channel, as I do for anyone else when I do this kind of thing, as well as their original video, which I definitely recommend you check them out. I gotta take some time to still check out some of their stuff, too. I'm still new to their channel. And maybe do a VR yourself. Why not? It's always interesting to hear the stories behind why we like the games that we do. Anyway, that's it. Thank you for watching, and I will see you later.